One of the first things that I like to do in this board is talk about sports and sports in society and how it relates. Because a lot of people, when they think about sports, they think, okay, yeah, it's about cute, nice little sports, and yes, okay, we have to have our entertainment. You know, a lot of people in universities would just be perfectly fine to do away with the athletic program. You know, they think it's a waste of money, they think it gets too much money or too much attention, and so they really don't care about it. In the media, oftentimes in the past, sports has been looked at as the toy department of the newspaper or the television station. But it's got a bigger impact than that, does it not? And what, you know, from your perspective, what do you see out in the realm, out in the world, from sports, and why does it have an impact? Why is it important?
It's a different sort of lifestyle. I don't think my sports myself, but there was a lot of social aspects to it, and learning social skills and how to work with other people and things like that. So there's a lot of side benefits that come to playing sports, whether it's a team sport or doubles and tennis or something like that. You learn some skills that you can use in other places in life.
Okay. So you learn a lot of those skills. I tell my son's soccer team when we play that rule number one is to have fun. Rule number two is to listen to coach. And rule number three is to work hard. And then we say that winning will take care of itself. Well, workout break this year, we won a division title. You know, we've been playing for 4 years together as a team. And our first season, we didn't win a game. And we were lucky if we scored. Our parents got all excited if we got close to scoring. But they've learned, you know, this core of boys has stayed together to the point now they've won a division title. Now they're moving up the division. They're going from 9-9 to 11-11. And we talk every day about the lessons that they're learning. It's not about winning a soccer game. It's about learning to work with teammates and learning to persevere and learning to be a good sport. And those are the things that individually we can learn from sports, okay? Who's there to provide this information? The sports reporter. That's who's writing about. That's who's reporting on what's going on. Why do we study sports? Well, because it's a major part of everyday life. Businesses are booming. Businesses will paint their windows. We had that competition a couple of years ago during homecoming where they had a window painting competition around town because of homecoming. But I mean, are they looking at homecoming at the university? When you think of homecoming at a university or at a high school, what are you thinking about? You're thinking about who's going to be the king or queen and the football game, right? I mean, we play a volleyball game and a soccer game during our homecoming at home, but everybody's focus is on the football game, okay? You look around and you'll see booster club signs because it's big business to support the booster club because that shows I care about my young people in the community. I want to get involved with it. One of the things we talked about in PR is if you want to increase your attendance, you have your youth program come to a ball game because fans flock to it. And the kids get in free, but mom and dad, they've got to pay. And they may bring grandma and grandpa. You know, we'd have the little youth dribbling things at basketball games. Everybody else is going to pay to come to it because sports is big business. All right? You look at Mary Jo Sylvester and Tom Witowski of USA Today. This is old and dated, but it's gone up still. Spending on Division I intercollegiate athletics increased on average about 25%. You think about Clemson University, just won the national title on their football team. They just built a new student success program with nap rooms, with a slide to take them from the first floor to the second floor, with their own coffee bar, with all these amenities. But then they also are in there teaching about financial planning and teaching about community service and these types of things. It's a multi-billion dollar facility. But then you look at where did all that money come from? Well, it came from television contracts, did it not? You know, the SEC, the Big 10, the Big 12, they signed these television contracts. That's where they get a lot of their money to be able to pay for all these things. Well, what's that done? Now ESPN can't afford to keep paying those television contracts, so they let go of 200 employees so they can stay up to date. The network or the landscape is changing because now you've got a lot of people that aren't watching games on television. They're watching online. We stream our games on the computer. You've got Twitter and Facebook now starting contracts so that they can do live productions. We have to pay for that. So it's a big business. It's something we have to keep thinking about, have to keep studying. Sociologists, the social arrangements created by people as they live together and make sense out of their lives. They are concerned with social issues, social relationships, social organization, and social change. Their overall goal is to enable people to understand, control, and change their lives so human needs are met at both individual and group levels. That's what sociologists are concerned with. So we study it, we study sports to find out why do people get so entangled in it? Why do they get so enraptured? There's all kinds of different studies. There's ageism studies. How does sports help you as you get older or hinder you as you think about the concussion studies, right? There's a lot that goes into racism in sports. I cannot believe in this day and age, earlier this year, a professional baseball player had racial slurs hurled at him in the middle of a ball game and felt threatened. This is 2017. How is that still happening? We have sexism studies that go on. I mentioned earlier, you might look at how in Olympic beach volleyball, the camera angles and the production involving the men's beach volleyball versus the women's beach volleyball. You look at the U.S. women's national soccer team and how they've won, I'm going to screw this up, they've won two world championships, right? Or one. I'm trying to remember. They've done very, very well. Let's put it that way. The men, not so much. But the men make a whole lot more money than the women. Now, you can argue, well, the men's team's been around a lot longer than the women's. You know, you're not going to take somebody who's just getting started playing on this stage and pay them the same amount as this group. Okay, I can make that argument. But then what about the success those teams have had and how much attention and how much pride they've given to the country? There's got to be some balance there. So those are studies we look at. We look at children's sports, youth sports, and why we have arguing and fighting. You think about the TV show Friday Night Tights that's become a national phenomenon, and it's that reality show about youth football in Texas and the stress they put on the kids and the way the parents behave. Why is that? Why are we living vicariously through our children? Is it because we're fighting, trying to get our kids the best advantage they can get so they can get a college scholarship? What is it we're looking at? Okay? So they're looking at sports as part of our culture. They look at why sports is important in our lives. You know, families will plan their vacations around their sporting events. I've had to think about that with my kids. You know, my son's going to go, Sporting KC has a soccer camp here next week. Well, we had to think about, okay, well, he's going to Vacation Bible School. He's helping there, and that gets out at 5:15, and the camp starts at 5, so what do we do with that? He's going to play in the Show Me State games. Okay, well, our family's going on vacation at this time, so we just have to make sure we're back at this time. And we're not gung-ho. We're not the diehards. We're the ones who really work hard to keep that balance, but we still want our son to have those opportunities. Okay. Politicians will include those sports references. Remember, it's a big deal who gets to go to the White House. This year is a big deal because Tom Brady has been an ardent fan of Donald Trump. Well, Donald Trump is not without his controversy, okay? Giselle, however you say her last name, Tom Brady's wife, does not like Donald Trump. Guess who did not go to the White House for the Super Bowl celebration? Tom Brady, because wife said, I don't want you going and attending this thing, so he didn't. But politicians get involved in this, okay? Lots of money going on, lots of attention going on. So who's here to report on it? Who's here to cover it? The sports reporter. We don't just write about games. We don't just do previews or game analysis. We talk about politics. We talk about health. We talk about sociology, all of that. And it's important for us to give all that information, okay? Again, why do we study sports? Because the landscape's changing. We have, you know, we were in our prime when it was just right, when it was the newspapers, when we went to the game, when we covered it. First of all, let's go a step back. How did radio change how news was covered, how sports were covered? Because before radio came along, newspapers, the reporter would go to the game, he'd watch the game, and I'd say he, because they were all men at the time. He would cover what was happening, he would do his interviews, and he would write up the game story and it would go in the next day's paper. Okay? Then radio came along. How would that have changed the game? And how would that have changed the way that sports was reported?
Radio would make the audience feel as though they were actually part of the game and not waiting for the actual reports to come in from someone else.
Okay, so I've got my radio and I'm listening to it on the radio and I'm getting all the news and everything and I'm hearing what's happening as if I'm there. I can't afford a ticket or it's not at a time where I can go, you know, so I'm going to listen to the radio. So how does that change the newspaper report?
This is how many outs in each or whatever you would put in there without the radio broadcast, because people have already listened to that and already know that they scored in seventh inning or whatever, so they have to have more other things.
Right. Only so many people could actually go to the game. Good chunk more were listening on the radio. Well, am I going to do a recap of the game they just watched on live or listened to on the radio? I've already got that. I already was a part of it. Now I want more. So what is sports reporting as a sports writing? What did it become?
Did it become journalism?
Well, it's still all journalism. Reporting and journalism are synonymous terms.
Like the stuff you talked about, where it's other things like politics, and I mean, you could talk about the fight, but that there was just a fight between the Tigers.
Yeah, it was the Giants, and was it the Giants and Tigers? My mom,
Giants,
I missed it. It was
Giants and Nationals.
Giants and Nationals, okay.
But the batter like went and started hitting, and you talk about more things like that instead of the actual
beef.
In a 2-0 game in the 8th inning, I thought that was ridiculous.
But sports writing became more analysis. It's still, and even to this day, we still report on the game and give analysis of the game and get the quotes and all of that and do a play-by-play, in essence, of what happened. But more of it has become the analysis. You know, what one player experienced. When you think about the Chiefs last year when Kelce came up behind the cornerback and just shoved it. Okay. Well, that becomes a sidebar, and we really delve into that a little bit more of why did he do it, what impact did it have on the game, and those types of things. Okay, so you get more of that. Then television comes along, and we can actually see it, right? What would you rather? Would you rather watch a game on television, or would you rather listen to a game on the radio?
For me, it would be television.
You'd rather watch it on television?
This sounds weird, but I'd rather listen to it on television. But because radio broadcasts are a little much for me, I don't know why. There's a difference between the way that TV, like the ones that are there mm-hmm. and on TV, they're different. But if I had the choice, I'd watch it.
You'd rather watch, because you want to see what's happening, right? You want to get the images and all of that, okay? Me personally, I'd rather listen to it on the radio. I want to see the action, and I want to see it unfold, and I want to see the plays happen. But I get distracted by the announcers. Because they don't talk, they're not, announcing's change is different, radio versus television, because I can see the picture. So I don't need you telling me everything that's going on. But then they start talking about all kinds of other stuff, and it gets distracting, and I'm like, oh yeah, there's a ball game going on. You know?
My dad will be at games because mm-hmm. we have season tickets, and he'll have headphones and listen to the radio broadcast as we're watching.
When I go to a game live, I miss that. I miss the analysis. I miss the discussion about it. I really miss replay. I love replay. But radio, they have to give you all the details. One thing that I'm going to start doing with the sports broadcasting class is teaching the announcers to announce like radio. Because most are going to come from here, and if they want to be announcers, their first job is going to be in radio. And several of our announcers have gone on to cover the local sports, or the local high school. And what happens is they're covering the game on radio like it's television. And I'm thinking, what quarter, if I don't come in right away, what quarter are we in? What's the score? How much time's left? And they're not used to giving that because they don't have to do that in television. So I'm going to have them go back and do it more like radio. Okay. But it changed because now we can see it. Now we can see the replay. And so radio had to think about, okay, how do we keep up so we get people still tuning into us? You just paint a better picture. You maybe have more analysis, you know, those types of things. But television also, now because you have this big block and we're selling much more time, now you get the pregame shows, and now you get the halftime show and the postgame show, and all of that comes along. So that has made a lot of those things obsolete, like the sports writer. Again, now I've watched it, I've already gotten to see hear the analysis and everything, What are you going to tell? What are you going to write about? And so it's made sports writing that much more difficult. Today you've got the internet, you've got the blogs, so many different channels, so many different places. Sports talk radio is everywhere. And you talk to people in PR. Last year when we went to Arrowhead, we got to meet with Bob Moore, who used to be their PR director and their historian, then he retired. He hates sports talk, can't stand it, because he thinks that they're just a bunch of frustrated athletes who are criticizing and talking about the sports. Well, in some ways, yes, they are. Some ways they are criticizing decisions that are made. But they're also doing it with a call-in to get people to discuss. So they're bringing that much more attention, okay? Bottom line is, we're just inundated with them, okay? Fans love their sports. Whether they're a casual fan or whether they're an avid fantasy sports fan, they love their sports and they want to get more invested and more involved. That's why we study, okay? So, as you are becoming a sports reporter, avid sports fans, they all think they can be a sports reporter, don't they? I mean, every time I teach my sports broadcasting class, I have students come in and say, yeah, I want to be an announcer. I'd be great at it. I love talking sports. I get with my friends, and you know, we'll talk about it all the time during the game, but we'll be watching the game, and I'll say, he should have done this, and this is why he did this. And a couple minutes later, the color commentator will say the same thing, and all my friends look at me and go, you ought to be doing that. You could do this. And then I put a mic in front of them. And it's like they've never seen the game before in their life because it is so different. There is a very big difference between us sitting in a room, watching a game, analyzing a game, and talking to one another, and then doing it live. Because doing it live, you have a lot of dead time you're going to have to fill. You need to do that prep work and know what to fill it with and what's important and what's not. You have to be able to do it quickly because the next play is coming along. So you want to get through that, all right? You're going to have to know the rules and the strategies. You're going to have to know why they do certain things. We had a gentleman last year who really wanted to be a sports reporter and knew soccer, he knew hockey, he knows martial arts, mixed martial arts, boxing, all, he knows all those sports, does not really know football, really know basketball, really know baseball. But those are the sports that we cover, okay? So we're doing a football game. And I'm having to teach him as we go along, and I'm going to give him the opportunity because this is a college and we're going to teach. But he calls it a sack because the quarterback takes off running, he gets tackled. Well, it's not a sack unless the quarterback's dropping back to pass and he gets tackled behind the line of scrimmage. They run the option, and he says they're running one of those trick plays. Well, that's not a trick play, that's the design. We're covering basketball, and there's an inbounds pass, and he's calling it a throw-in. And I have to say, that's not a throw-in, this is basketball, not soccer, that's an inbounds pass. But you have to know the rules and the strategies. You have to know what's going on so you can talk about it. There are some that know, or avid sports fans, they know a healthy or unhealthy amount of sports trivia. I had a young man who worked here, or was here a couple years ago, and he'd be talking during a ball game, and he would go off on some tangent about some obscure athlete from some other team from 5 years ago that fans don't know about, but he wanted to show off his trivia and how much information he knew. Well, it's got to fit. You've got to make it fit what you're talking about. Sports reporters know how to do that. The avid fan thinks that he or she can do it. It's more tricky than that, okay? You don't just get paid to watch ball games. I mean, I used to always brag and tell people, they'd ask what I did for a living, I'd say, I get paid to go to sporting events. You do get paid to go to sporting events, but it is much more than that, okay? It's also not just covering football, baseball, and basketball. Now, I will tell you, that if you want to get into this field, you have to know football. You're just going to have to know it. Whether you ever cover it or not, probably to get to the point where you want to go, you're going to have to cover football. Why? Because football is a cash cow. That's where the money is. And so to get to that point where you want to be, if you want to be an Olympic reporter, that's great. But to get there, you're going to have to start smaller. And one of the things you're going to have to be able to cover is football. But there is lacrosse, there is field hockey, there's rugby, there's triathlon. there are other sports, and the more you know about them, that's the reason in our sports broadcasting program, we cover all of our sports versus other schools who do football, volleyball, and basketball. We do all of them because I want my students to be better prepared, okay? It also requires a lot of research. That work you do before you get to the game. So you know the stories within the stories. You know the game within the game. You have to be able to know that coming in so you know how to frame your story. If you've got a running back, for instance, who's about to break a school record for career yardage, and you go in and you don't know that, and then you write your story and he's broken it and you have no idea and you don't put out your story, you have immediately lost credibility. So that has got to be a part. It also requires that you check your allegiances at the door. There's no cheering in the press box. You have to be professional. I always tell this story. I told you I played football here at the university. Well, then when I got done, and I also worked in the sports information office that whole time. Well, after I was finished, I went to graduate school here, and I started working in the press box doing football games. Well, at the time, the sports information director paid $10 a game to his staff group, and he would come around about 5 minutes left in the game, and he'd have everybody a $10 bill. Well, I kept getting riled up during the game, and I would have these outbursts, and he kept saying, "Joe, calm down, there's no cheering in the press box." And he walked up to me, he took us $10, and he looked at me, and he went, shoved it in his pocket. I was making a point. I told you and told you time and again, there is no cheering in the press box. And he made his point, and I never cheered in the press box ever again. So, and it's hard, because especially if it's your hometown team. Dave Cobb was the sports editor of the Warrensburg Daily Star Journal when I worked in sports information. And we used to give him UCM gear because he was our local guy. And our athletic director used to get upset that he would never wear it when he was covering our games. He would always wear a Warrensburg High School baseball cap. And I asked him one day, I said, "So what is that?" He said, "I don't work for the university. I work for the Daily Star Journal. And I don't want it to look like I'm covering for the university. I'm trying to be professional," which made perfect sense to me. Now, when he covered Warrensburg High, he wore UCM stuff. So you have to think about those things. You're the hometown reporter, but you still have to tell the story accurately. Okay, you still, if the team's not playing well, you have to mention that they're not playing well. If they are playing great, you don't want too much hyperbole or oversell it. If the coach is on the chopping block, you need to report that the coach is on the chopping block. You do have to be very careful with this, particularly in a small town. A few years ago, one of my graduates was doing the radio for the high school, and the coach made two or three really, really bad decisions that cost him the game. And he was on the radio and he was critical of the coach. And he said, "I'm gonna talk to him about it after the game. It's gonna be brutal. We're gonna talk about this, we're gonna hash this out." And there was kind of the overwhelming belief around the community was that he was not doing a good job coaching his team. But they didn't want to hear the reporter say that. They didn't want to hear that on the radio because that's still their coach. By all accounts, and I knew the guy personally, great, great guy. Not the greatest head football coach. And the reporter got crucified. People were calling into the station saying they were going to pull their ads. They wanted somebody else on the air. So he got put on probation. You know, so he was being accurate. But you also have to know what's that line that I'm crossing, particularly when you're talking about high school sports. Because in high school, you dance with wet brung you. You can't recruit, you don't hire, you don't sign, okay? So you have to think about that. Okay. Some other things you need to keep in mind. Number one, you need to verify your sources. Make sure that you're getting your information accurately. One thing that in sports, coaches, athletes complain about with the media is you didn't quote me accurately. One thing that I would do is always go back and I would share the quotes with them. You know, you never let a subject read your story verbatim, but you can always give the quote and say, "This is what I've got you saying. Is this correct?" And share that with them. Okay. And if you record it, they can't come back and say, "I never said that." Well, you have the recording. I can write something wrong, but I've got it recorded. I have that right. So make sure that you verify your sources where you get your information. If you burn them, you've lost all credibility. Okay, and this applies to any kind of report. All right? Follow the SPJ Code of Ethics and the Associated Press Sports Editors Ethics Guidelines. We'll talk about that here in just a minute. Remember, unless you're writing a column or a blog, you are reporting facts. What happened? If it was a boneheaded play, if it was a bad call, if they shouldn't have blitzed in that situation, or they should have called a timeout to set up a three-point shot, or they should have sent the runner, that's your opinion. Keep that out. Just note that they did do it. Okay? Then if you're going to do a column or write your own blog, then you can share your point of view. Okay? And you must cover your beat. You have to be there. When I was with Missouri Southern to cover women's soccer, the guy that covered it for the Joplin Globe, that covered women's soccer for the Joplin Globe, we played on Fridays and Sundays. Well, Friday was his day off, so he never came to our games. And I was always like, well, then why don't y'all get another beat writer, or why don't you take another day off? You're never at our games. And he said, well, you always send me the game notes and the game recap anyway. I could say whatever I wanted to. I was the PR guy, you know? I love PR. I love what I did. But I'm going to flower this up to make us look as good as possible. You need to be there to see what happened. You need to have those relationships. Because if we go, you know, win a national championship and you want to come cover us at that point, I'm not giving you a pass. You've got to be there. So get out and cover your beat. You must find the importance of the uniqueness in every game. We had again, when I was in Missouri Southern, we had a basketball team that went 4-22. And we were awful. I mean, average defeat was like 25 points. We just got hammered for 22 games. And I had to find some way to write the post-game story for that every single time. So you're going to have to find the uniqueness, okay? It is okay to listen to talk radio and watch the pregame shows, but your job is to provide information, because what are they doing on talk radio and in pregame and postgame shows? What's their job?
Their job is to provide a story on what happened in the event.
They're not really providing the story of what happened. What are they doing? And they're talking about what happened, but they're going beyond what happened. Think about the Super Bowl 3 years ago, was it? When Seattle's playing New England and they try and pass. Instead of giving it to Marshawn Lynch and have him dive in from the one, they had three plays to do it. They throw a pass, throw an interception. Was that Seahawks and the Patriots?
Yeah, it was.
Okay. So they're talking about that happening. But what are they going beyond that and doing? For the post-game show, talk about pre-game here, but same thing, post-game, on talk radio, what are they talking about?
They're talking about that play.
They're talking about that play, but they're not just saying it happened. What are they doing?
They're saying stuff like they should have done a rushing play because it would have been easier. Pete Carroll is not a very good coach for making that kind of call, especially at that.
They're analyzing it. They should have run it. You've got three plays. You've got this guy that is averaging this many yards a game. They've got to run it. Well, no, they don't want to run it because this running back is like 10% in gaining that 1 yard on a 4th-and-1. Everybody knows he's going to get it, and he can't overcome that. So you're smart to try and run that play. It's just bad execution. They're analyzing, okay? They're critiquing what happened. But as the reporter that's actually covering just this event, your job is to provide the information, okay? So you have to think about, the point I'm trying to make here is you have to think about what kind of reporter are you. If you're doing the game and you're doing the play-by-play, you're saying it happened. If you're doing the color commentary, you're saying why it happened or what they could have done differently. If you're covering the game for the paper, you're writing this is what took place. If you're writing a column, this is what they should have done. If you're the talk show host, this is what they should have done. No, they should have done it this way, and you're given the pros and cons. Okay, so you have to think about that. You do need to look the part. Be professional. People think that sports reporters are all going to come in looking slovenly and look like wannabe athletes, you know, overweight, shirt half untucked, and tie rumpled, hair is a mess. Be professional. You're not necessarily going to go in a suit and tie because you are going to a sporting event, but a polo and some nice slacks is going to be the best bet. Okay? So how do you get started? Well, number one, you read as much as you can. Sports Illustrated, ESPN.com, sports section of your local paper. Read as much as you can, because that's where you kind of learn how to turn the phrase. You learn a lot of the lingo that way. I can teach you some of the basics in this class, but you're really going to learn to be a sports reporter by listening to talk shows, by watching the evening news, by reading it, by getting as much information as you can that way. Okay? Try and get an internship or a clerk's position at a paper. Okay? Rachel, have you done any writing for the meal scanner?
No.
Okay. Probably need to start doing some of that. You helped us out doing a couple of games last year before you even taking the class. So that's a good place to start. Evan doing your internship this summer is going to be a great place for you to start. Jake, who's listening, who's going to be with us in the future, but he's the editor for the Meal Scanner. That's a great place to start. I think Jake wants to work in radio. He's doing an internship in radio. But writing for the Meal Scanner, where you're having to cover all the different sports, you're learning about deadlines, you're learning about interviewing and scheduling, that's all a great place to gain that experience. Okay, so that's where you want to get your, you want to get started. And then develop your own skills. You know, whether you start writing a blog, whether you take a reporter and you cover a local sporting event by yourself, and you take record yourself doing it so you can go back and listen and critique it, that's going to be important for you. Okay, do that homework. Study up on the teams that you're going to be looking at. If you're going to be you said you want to work for the Royals, Rachel, do some research about the teams that are playing and see about writing up your own game notes if you're going to be the commentator, do the color or do the sideline or what have you. Learn those skills. Bottom line, no matter what area you go into, reporting is still reporting. Whether it's sports, whether it's politics, whether it's health, whether it's education, reporting is still reporting. And when it comes to sports, whether it's as a newspaper writer, whether it's as a play-by-play host, whether it's on sports talk, you have to do that homework. You have to make sure you know about the teams that you're covering. Okay. Work on your interviewing skills. We have a class here called Improving Interviewing Skills. It's on the comm studies side, but I encourage all of my students to take it, because you're learning more about asking questions, listening for responses. Now, how can I feed off of that? Because what happens whenever you've got a list of 10 questions, and I find myself, I still do this. You want to stay with those 10 questions, right? I mean, you've prepared that. You know kind of what angle you're looking at for this story, right? But what if they take you in a different, more interesting angle, and you're locked into your 10 questions? Then you're kind of hosed, because you had a better story, and you were so focused here, you missed it. If you're thinking about question number 3, and you're not really listening to the response to 2, because you know I'm recording it, I'll listen to it later. And then you go back and listen to your tape recording, you're like, oh, I should have gone that line. That was much more interesting. Okay. Final word, this is from Jasandi. There's time for a phone call, make it. If it's an article worth reading, find it. If you can get your hands on a rule book, read it. If a colleague has a good scorekeeping system, steal it. If there's a practice or event scheduled, attend it. If there's the tiniest prospect of an interview, grab it. Think about these things. Practice or event scheduled, attend it. Good practices, because you kind of learn a little bit more about what it is they're trying to do. Or you may see that a player is sitting out with a boot on his leg. That gives you some feedback. You can find out a little more about that. Article worth reading, find it. Maybe there's a research article that came out about concussions, and you're going to do a story about concussions. We had a few years ago, whenever we first got our turf on our football field, there was a big article in a couple of papers about, excuse me, about staph infection coming from these new fields, because you get the rug burn off of those fields. Well, they hold that staphylococcus virus in the turf. You know, the truck tires are ground up to hold everything down. They get a lot of heat. The virus builds up in there. And guys would get tackled, and they would scuff their arm, and then they would get that staph infection or put it in the turf. Nobody locally looked at that. Nobody did a story on it. I'm thinking, we're getting that kind of feel. Are we concerned about it? How are we going to overcome it? What are our trainers looking for? How do they treat it? There's so much you could have done with that. Nobody looked at saw that article or thought it was worth reading, so they missed it. Okay. If you do all that, the game's going on, and you're ready to go, then you're going to be well on your way to becoming a sports reporter. Okay. So where have our graduates ended up? Well, Time Warner Cable, Niles Media Group, 610 and 810 Sports. We have a sports writer at Jeff City Tribune. We have a sports editor at Cincinnati Democrat. We've had the last three high schools, football and basketball, play-by-play announcers for the local radio station. This young lady with KQTV in St. Joe, she actually got out of sports because she really loved covering sports. She still loves sports, but it's a small station up in St. Joseph, and they needed somebody to go out and cover a fire one night. She was the only one there. She goes, "I'll go." Went out and covered hard news, fell in love with it. Well, she's now down in Savannah, Georgia, at number 90 going to market. So,
wow,
sports got her where she wanted to be. KNBC TV in Kansas City. We're also at Channel 5 in Kansas City, the Indy Star in Indianapolis. This young man came in as a freshman, became the sports editor of the Wheel Scare as a sophomore, I believe it was. Wrote 100 stories his freshman year, was our journalism student of the year. He broke the story for the New York Times on Jerry Sandusky, the sex abuse scandal at Penn State. So that was one of our students who broke that story. Okay? So bottom line, there's a lot of information I just gave you right there. But the bottom line is sports is huge in our society. Whether it's just covering the games, whether it's analyzing the games, whether it's talking about health risk with concussions, with knee injuries, with things like that, whether it's covering high school sports, whether it's talking about youth sports, whether it's the business side of it. You think about the Los Angeles Raiders, or the Oakland Raiders, who are now moving to Las Vegas. And what does that mean for Oakland and for Las Vegas? The Rams leaving St. Louis, and why they left St. Louis to go back to LA. You know, the business aspect, the political side. Our society is inundated with sports. And it's not just because we really don't think about higher level things. There's a lot going on with sports. My wife and I get in this debate every year around Thanksgiving of why are they playing games on Thanksgiving? And I said, it's just part of the tradition of our country. She said, well, don't they want to go be with their families on Thanksgiving? And I've always said, you know, the teams have a dinner together and they bring their families in. And she's like, yeah. But what about the people who work concessions and the people who work security and the people who do the grounds and the ticket takers and all of those people that, she goes, and for your background, those broadcasters, they don't get to be with their family. I always lose the argument. Okay? But you think about, when we think about sports, we think about who? The players. There's a whole lot of other people who are involved in a sporting event. It's a multi-billion dollar industry. Your discussion board post for this week is talking about who should pay for it. When a stadium comes to town, say for instance the Kansas City Chiefs wanted to build a new downtown stadium, what's one of the first things they discuss? Who's going to pay for it? Is it the ownership? Because it's their team, they're the ones who want the stadium. Or is it Kansas City? Is it the taxpayers? Because it's revenue. I mean, it creates a lot of jobs. I mean, you have to build the thing. That's going to create a lot of jobs to build it. It's going to create a lot of jobs to maintain it, right? It's going to bring tourist dollars because people will come to town to watch the Chiefs. But then there's all other discussions of, okay, well, yeah, it's going to create jobs to build it, but once it's built, they don't have the job anymore. And the tourism dollars, people aren't coming to Kansas City just to watch the Chiefs. So that's your discussion board post for this week is who should pay for it. Because of the business, because of the sociological aspect of it. As far as becoming the reporter, so you can report on all these things, not just the game itself. Do your homework. Learn as much about the industry and about the field as you can and how it impacts our society. Okay? One last thing, and we'll take a quick break. I talked about the code of ethics. The code of ethics, number one, the newspaper pays for its staffers' way for travel accommodations, food, and drink. Now, it says newspaper, this should go for pretty much any media outlet. The media outlet is going to pay, not the team, because you don't want the reporter feeling beholden to the team. Okay. Editors and reporters should avoid taking part in outside activities or employment that might create conflict of interest or even appearance of a conflict. So if I'm a sports reporter for the Kansas City Chiefs, that's my beat. I work for the Kansas City Star, and I cover the Chiefs, that's my beat. And then I get a job doing PA announcing for Sporting KC. That could potentially be a conflict because, yeah, I'm writing for the Chiefs, but we also, the Star still covers Sporting KC, and if I have an in there, I'm probably going to hear things that have happened with Sporting KC. Maybe they're going to make a big trade. Maybe the coach is on the chopping block, something like that. As a reporter, that's tips I've gotten. I should be sharing them. Well, Sporting KC probably doesn't want that stuff getting out until they're ready to release it. So I've got a conflict of interest there. Writers and writers groups should adhere to APME and APSE. Those are the editing, or editors groups. Should appear to those standards. No deals, discounts, or gifts except those of insignificant value or those available to the public. So, for example, I shouldn't get free tickets. I should not get apparel. I've talked about our local sports editor. We got him shirts and hats and things like that. It's a little different on a smaller scale, but you do have to be careful how much you do. There are some places, for example, that are so strict with those rules that, say the office professional was getting married and somebody sent flowers. Somebody from the athletic department sent flowers to that person, to the staffer. Well, they won't accept the flowers because it's looked at as a gift. They'll maybe have them put it out on the front desk or something like that. Okay. Not accept free tickets again, I just said that. Should be carefully consider the implications of voting for all awards and all-star teams and decide if such voting creates a conflict of interest. That one's tough because that's who they turn to for all conference teams, all-star teams, is the media. That's who media writers are who vote for the players who get inducted in the Professional Hall of Fame. So they are the ones that have to do that. But there's a lot of places that will say, no, we don't want you doing it because it will create a conflict of interest. I don't necessarily agree with that, but, you know. Unethical guidelines should be followed. Assignments should be made on merit without regard for race or gender. So whenever you're given the assignment, for example, Rachel, there's no reason you shouldn't be able to cover football. My sister hates to turn on a football game and hear a female color commentator or play-by-play. I'm like, why? Well, I can see maybe play-by-play, but color, she's never played football. Well, true. Doesn't mean she doesn't know anything about it. So don't let your gender slow you down, okay? I will tell you, you will have a fight. Fight it. It's worth fighting.